Hey everybody, it's Jason Blaha here, and once again it's time for the Q&A, so let's go ahead and knock this out. All right, first question. I have a somewhat different question. Can you take away the bicep curls from Ice Cream Fitness 2.0 and still reach intermediate without any imbalances, perhaps if you change the pendlay rows to supinated as well? I do not care about curls, as some seem to do, only about long-term strength and hypertrophy in my entire body. All right, this is something that's been coming up a lot as far as people saying, hey, can I need chin-ups. I need chin-ups in there. Can I take the rows out? No, don't take the rows out. And I don't want you doing supinated rows. Do the pronated grip rows. You're going to need the grip training for it, for your deadlift, right? You're going to need that. So the question becomes, how can you work chins in? You know what? I really wrote the program with the intention that people would do the curls, because again, everyone wants to do curls, but if someone really wanted to replace the curls with chin-ups, a person who is strong enough to do at least 8 chins, right? Now, if you're starting out as a ranked novice, you probably can't do 8 chin-ups. Let's just be realistic here. You probably can't, in which case you need to just go ahead and do the curls and the rows until you're strong enough, and then you could rotate the chins in. But someone who is strong enough to do legitimately 8 dead hang chin-ups, they wanted to replace the curls with them, that's probably okay. It's probably okay. Alternatively, a person could also do something like greasing the groove on their off days using chin-ups as part of their GPP. That's also an option. But generally speaking, taking the rows out, probably not a good idea early on because it's very low volume deadlifting. And if you replaced the rows with chins, which a lot of people seem to ask if they could do, your deadlift's gonna suffer for it. Your deadlift is going to suffer, in my opinion. Not really a good option. But if a person is strong enough, which means they are not a rank novice, and they're probably at a fairly low body fat already, which means hopefully they're bulking and eating, they could possibly get away with doing the chin-ups in place of the curls. It's going to depend on the person. All right, next question. How would I go about programming small muscle group exercises for a sport-specific or competitive goal? Example, a strict curl competition. If the purpose isn't general strength and one just wants to get a specific small muscle group exercise, would the programming principles be the same as those for the big three? Thanks. No, it's not going to be the same. The reason smaller muscles tend to, particularly isolation type exercises, we'll just call them single joint exercises because I hate that word, isolation. Single joint exercises, it's easier to tear connective tissue on. It is easier to damage joints on. Therefore, you can't necessarily program the same low reps that you would for bigger exercises, right? Conversely, single joint movements like the strict curl don't require as much motor unit learning as a multi-joint exercise either. So in theory, if you just got your biceps as big as possible, through whatever exercises you had available, right? And I would lean you in the direction of things like cheat curls. I would lean you in the direction of weighted chin-ups. I would push you in the direction of all of those in addition to doing strict curling to build your overall size and strength of the bicep. But just remember, a single joint exercise like that doesn't have as much motor unit learning, so you don't necessarily need to practice the movement pattern as much, but you will need to practice doing heavy curls, obviously, and heavy strict curls for your competitive environment, but not as much as you would need to practice a squat or a bench press. You mainly need to focus upon hypertrophy and strength of that muscle. But the problem we run into is that if you're going to use smaller exercises for it, you just can't use the same low reps because your injury risk is higher than on a big exercise in which load is spread across multiple joints and tendons. And you don't benefit as much from it because there's not as much of a motor unit issue. So I would say in that case, just throw tons of volume with exercise selection that causes the least amount of connective tissue inflammation, because that's usually a limiting factor with small exercises. How much connective tissue inflammation can you handle? And are you using smaller movement patterns that really aren't natural movements that put that stress on the connective tissue? All right, and that's what you have to factor in. All right, next question. Is your novice program 2.0 also suitable for people that can hit the gym only twice a week, or would the volume be too low? All right, that could be a problem. If you're only able to get to the gym twice a week, the volume might be a little bit too low. And what I mean is that Tulo to really get fantastic results. If your time only allows you to get to the gym twice a week and all you can do is perform the workout at its normal volume, I would rather you do that, and I would rather you get the longer breaks between sets to lift the heaviest weight possible than try to cram more volume in with a limited time frame in the gym, right? So I would say go ahead and run the program as normal if that's all your time will allow for. You'll still make pretty good gains. You just won't make anywhere near maximum gains. However, by that same token, if you have more time on the 2 days, let's say you do have an hour and a half or up to 2 hours twice a week that you could train, but you can't get in for 3 days. Well, it makes sense to utilize more volume in that case. And when I mean more volume, you could go ahead and run it as a 5x5. And that would probably be acceptable with the added caveat, as long as it's not forcing you to reduce the weight. In other words, if you're going to take it to a 5x5, you're looking at least another 6 to 7 minutes per exercise, because you're going to need 3 minute plus breaks between them, if not more. So realistically, you need to program another 10 minutes per exercise. So if the 4 exercises you might be doing, right, you're looking at another 40, 45 minutes. That's what you're going to need in extra gym time to add appropriate volume. Because if you're adding volume, but at the expense of reducing weight on the bar to squeeze a 5x5 in, it's not going to be as good. I would rather you just take the longest breaks possible and get the normal in. But if you really have the extra time to spend and you can get away with something like 2 hours on those 2 days, you could extend the program out to a 5x5 and progress on it and only come in twice a week. And you would probably make slightly better progress than you would on the program as it's written, only 2 days a week. So that's the direction I would go. But I would base it upon what you have for time available. All right, next question. Can people with really good genetics gain muscle by doing mediocre exercises, bodyweight push-up, bodyweight pull-up, cables, machines, etc.? I always can find a few people like this, usually with less time and resources available to work out with. What's your thoughts on this? Usually those guys are really, really lean. A lot of times you're seeing an epigenetic expression, meaning some people early on in the gym, due to certain genes being turned on earlier in life, gain muscle really easily at first, even off of goofy exercises that other novices don't, right? But you need to keep in mind, bodyweight pull-ups done for a lot of volume is a tremendous mass builder. So that's not a goofball for a mediocre exercise. If someone actually got in and worked on trying to hit 20 bodyweight pull-ups every single day, no matter how they had to space them out, even if it was singles, that person's going to get a big upper body. That's just going to happen eventually. Right? That's not a mediocre exercise. But you're seeing usually an epigenetic expression. And actually, I don't believe that there's an enormous variation in muscle mass potential genetically in people. I really don't. I haven't observed that. It's just it takes some people longer than others for all the genetic expression to come out. It seems to be based largely on epigenetics. And in other words, if you put in enough years in the gym, you will have a similar potential to someone else with a similar structure, even if they appeared to have better genetics at first. In terms of just musculature. Now, how you look is more genetic than your overall size, right? That's been my experience. It's how you look matters a lot on insertion, shape, and then ultimately body fat. But what you see, those people who you're thinking of, it's oftentimes some epigenetics combined with people who are just naturally really lean, who start out very, very lean. And so therefore the muscle shows better because they're leaner, and they may not even be as big as you think they are. You'd be surprised. The guy you're thinking of, who you're thinking of as really big, might only be 160 pounds and then have no legs, right? They're there, but there are just genetic freaks who just grow initially no matter what. But a lot of them started out fairly big and lean due to epigenetics as well. It's not just the training that they did. And you can activate those genes later in life through training, whereas then they had some of the benefits of training that just turned on for various reasons. And there's actually, that's been researched and looked at. That's an interesting phenomenon in people. Again, some data on epigenetics and that. All right, next question. Jason, if you have pain in your mid-back from squatting, is a front squat a safe alternative? Yeah, if you want your mid-back to hurt even worse. Realistically, you need to remember that the front squat, if your form breaks down even remotely, and I mean even remotely, like you hit even a heavy rep that's close to being a grinder, or you get within one rep of your max, it's going to work your thoracic erectors harder than a back squat will. And you're going to feel it more in your mid-back. So what I would say is that, look, if your mid-back is a weakness there and it's hurting, because if you're feeling pain in your mid-back, you've got a weak T-spine. Do exercises to correct that and continue to back squat. Do exercises to correct that. But what you need to remember, for some people, the front squat is for some of them a good way to strengthen their middle back. Right, the front squat actually hits certain parts of your spine more than a back squat does with comparable rate of perceived exertion. So I think what you're noticing is, again, possibly just thoracic spine weakness, which, you know, I can relate to. I've suffered my own issues from it. So again, some seated good mornings or safety bar squat good mornings will help you with that. Do a lot of face pulls, just different things like that. Sort it out. That's what I would do, and just keep back squatting. All right, guys, but that's really all I have to say on that today. I hope it's been informative, and I will talk to you guys next time in part 2.